Ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor, and I'm not kidding, to introduce the reigning indoor and outdoor world champions of NMP, PCH, HayaBusa. Here they are. Dennis Prate, David Grauitz, Andy Grauitz, Jiwang, Bob Nolle, and Coach Gary Smith. And to Brian, come. No, oh, hey, I went. Hey guys, we are missing somebody. Where is he?
Our cameraman?
Yeah, him too. Your father. Oh,
he's guarding upstairs.
Wisely, he's on the back.
He's usually a true companion of the team. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, once again, second thing is, did you know that this is David's and Andy's 100th four-way competition?
With HayaBusa.
With HayaBusa.
Yes.
Of course.
Yes.
So HayaBusa is the 100th competition?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, fantastic, yeah. Guys. Congratulations.
Yes, it's nice to like also to celebrate that Unicom actually here in where we had our biggest success in throughout the whole history. So it's very nice.
How many of those 100 have you won?
76.
He knows his numbers.
Yeah. 76%.
And they have been undefeated. First of all, also, they have attended every single world challenge so far since 2006.
2005.
Mm-hmm. And they have won each of them since 2011.
Yes.
Yes.
Seven times.
Pretty good.
Yeah. Also, that is special. So that's also why it feels so. So it's always an honor to come here and to perform well, and then also to celebrate our 100th competition here. It's actually by coincidence maybe, but it's nice to celebrate it here.
We're very happy for that to be here. Yeah, brilliant. Yeah,
thank you.
And in 2011 and 12 and 13 and 14, you were not world champions and you still won the world challenge.
Yeah, well, we considered the World Challenge actually as the unofficial World Championship indoor, while there was not any World Championship indoor officially yet. So I think until 2014, we also felt that we were the indoor world champion, not by title, but by winning this major competition. And I think later on, when it became like official, I think we just kept on the winning streak.
And now you have some new goals to make history.
Yeah.
Who wants to elaborate on that? I'd explain that a little bit. There is a
So we're currently, since 2011, first of all, we're on an indoor winning streak of this would be the 23rd consecutive time that we win an indoor meet with the team. And then also on the outdoor side, we're trying to do a hat trick of world titles back to back. So those are
three members, right?
Three members.
Yeah. So then the next goal after that would be with four members.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. All of that hasn't been done yet, even not by Gary. Gary, you've won two consecutive.
I'm too old.
Four-way gold medals.
Yeah, I won two consecutive. So. They've done it, and obviously Bob is one behind, and that's the big goal. If we can win in Australia, I think it would be amazing, but a lot of hard work still to go.
Teams are on your heels. They don't, you know, people don't like to see that, how you're kind of walking away, you know, with everything. There's Wemby. They have been chasing you last year. They can't give up. Now they're here with a new lineup. They tied you in round two.
Great.
And maybe round three.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Yeah, it'll be it's slow, and of course we discussed it yesterday with you. Is that there will be jumps that they will be good at, same with airspeed, and the gap will not be that good, but or that big. But we have to hope that as the jumps come that allow us to go into our own specialities, that we can open up a gap. That's the plan.
And the fast rounds are coming, right?
Yes, yeah, exactly.
There's a team that is famous to be very good with fast rounds, right?
Yeah, but Wemby is also, we expect them to be super fast. But it's a case of, can you be consistently, you know, over the three fast jumps that are coming? It'll be a case of, you have to go with the trained team more than the untrained team. But you have to take your hat off to Wemby. They're doing good, and I think Airspeed will also be strong.
Yeah, so and there's the Airspeed who came to the World Challenge. They haven't been here since 2012, and they came to meet you.
Yeah.
So that's wonderful, you know, that they make the effort to meet.
Yeah, we welcome them with our open arms.
We do actually have your videos available. Do we want to watch that one?
Videos, let's look at this. Let's look at all the videos. Whatever we have.
The last one.
Yeah.
The last one we didn't see from their own eyes.
We'll play round one first.
Yeah.
Round two.
Let's see what we got. Round one, two. Do we have videos?
We've got about 3 seconds before it plays.
Yeah.
But yeah, so round one, it was 10HF13, and you guys scored 31 points, which is pretty impressive. So you're just starting the 10.
Yeah, and then, okay, let's look at this. So you're commenting it between coach and team. What did you like, what not?
I think this was a very good jump to start the competition off. Obviously, everybody had their first round nerves. But we definitely felt like we had like the fire was there to perform well, and the energy level was good. I don't think we could have done any better on this one. I think it was a nice round to start things off.
Yeah. I really like the speed you're closing the tens out.
Yeah, it looks very controlled too at the same time, you know, very...
For me, I watched
round one to make sure everything is solid.
No, I watched the, not from this angle, but I watched obviously Wemby and Airspeed, and theirs looked a little bit sloppier relative to that one. So, and I think that's almost where the point difference comes in. They looked super confident in the flying, it was smooth, as opposed to when we go to the second jump.
Yes. Yeah.
Then you'll start to see the difference here.
This one, the second one. Round the way you attack the dive straight from the door.
This jump, we just, we took it a little bit too fast. We took the same speed of round one into this round, and this one is a little bit more technical, and also has, on this one, we have to deal with a little bit more levels, and that's the thing.
26, 22.
Killed a little bit the flow in the whole jump.
But it's still amazing. I mean, it's a three blocks and not really fast blocks. And now we are up to, for a three block sequence, to 25 points. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, was this the lowest score of the meet right now?
And the next one. And the one that's...
I mean, this jump, it really... And we're happy with the score, considering how it felt, because we were getting stuck on some various places, and the jump never was flowing, you know, as we would hope for. But I guess with an average performance, we're still happy with the score. Yeah.
Average performance 25 for a three block sequence. Okay, fine.
Yeah, but it's because we know on training we can do better, and it's just like on competition sometimes you do stuff that you don't do in training. And
Gary, if you compare this to, I mean, I had, yesterday we talked about, I had to admit that this is a different sport now compared to...
I'm with you.
No, you're coaching them. So, but if you compare this to D-Land Magic, D-Land Fire, is that also a different dimension now?
Or? For sure. I mean, the whole flying style has changed, as if you watch soccer or rugby. I watched South African rugby the other day and I couldn't believe, not only have the rules changed, but just the whole technique and the physical side of it is so different to when I played as a young South African boy, you know. So obviously for them, if we went back to D-Land Magic, we would look at this and go, whoa, well, what are we doing here, you know? But I would have hoped that if we could have stayed in it, you would evolve with the tunnel. The tunnel has changed, you know. Obviously these guys have pushed it. When you speak about Airspeed coming here and the Wemby, it's a case of everyone is pushing them, and they want to catch. Everybody wants to beat HayaBusa. We know that, and I think almost the world is waiting for a change. we've discussed it, and I don't think it's a bad thing. You cannot always win, but on the other side, it means that they are being pushed harder and harder, and they have to work harder. You know, so I would think if I go back to my days, yes, it's totally different. I say to them honestly, I can see what they're doing, but I can't do what they're doing. You know. So as a coach, I understand what we have to do and where to do, and I can tell them what to do. But as long as they don't say, you do it, coach.
But I think also, we're now 10 years more further ahead, like Gary's top period. Who knows that in my 10 years and ahead in the future, I will definitely tell the same thing. So the good thing in the sport is still growing, and we're like discovering new grounds. Okay, we are pushing the boundaries, but sooner or later another team will push that boundary, and just to
especially with the young kids coming.
We just had the team here before. We had Jet Maxi, and they say, "HayaBusa, we are coming."
I'm the coach.
Hold him back. No, that's going to be the future of the tunnel sport. And will it then, I think we've had a discussion before, will that start to push a big split between outdoor skydiving and indoor? Already you feel it, the pressure for them to do both. Mm. But if you're just doing indoor, the kids, who knows when they grow up and they're 18, 19, 20 and they're only doing indoor, it could become a total different sport.
And some have already transitioned now to outdoor. You know, there's the French former forward junior who is jumping with the Monaco team now. And they have a team in the AAA class now, which is on a 25 average level almost or whatever. It's incredible, yeah.
No, I mean, it will be interesting. And obviously, I don't expect every child that's flying in the tunnel to become a skydiver. We know it's a different it's a different ball game. So, but that will be interesting.
Yeah, plus team need to develop. Eh? I mean, it's not because it is your first team. This is also not the first HayaBusa lineup. So throughout the years, when you shape your next team, you know what you're looking for, and the target is still to become better as a team.
So let's look at the lineup. How is your, you scrambled the whole slots, and how is your youngest member doing?
Well, I think I hang in there. No, it's nice because now we're at the fourth year with this lineup. So the first 2 years is actually like almost struggling a bit through those training camps, and just there's so much coming at you that you need to perform, but you also just need some time and some repetitions to pick everything up. And now at this stage we can experiment a little bit with like different randoms, different blocks that we might mirror some stuff. So it's only now that it's really opening up. So I'm actually looking forward to training this year because it's actually a new world that's opening up for us.
And you defended the Belgian gold medal of 2014 successfully with 2 years in
preparation.
Preparation for that. In 2016, so that was not an easy. I mean, you had to work a lot. The whole team had to work a lot to develop this. You know, how was it for you, Gary? I mean, that was a big job.
It was a challenge, but I think also, I mean, in compliments to Bob. Not only has he done a great job in the sky, but also on the ground, the team has pulled together and they work well together. And it's difficult because a lot of the debrief was aimed at Bob. But also to the other three, we had to change certain things on the front pair and say, well, this is different to what we had with Roy. It's going to turn different, or there's different powers, sizes. And so in that sense, it was a challenge. But I must say, hats off to the whole team, because they made my job almost easier. Because we had with Roy, and there was the big pressure of this was our year to win it. And when Bob came in, nobody expected anything. So it was one of those that we wanted to win. That was the goal. It was a case of, could we defend it? And as we got better and better with Bob, we said, yes, we can defend. And so in that sense, it was, I think it was a great job for me.
And some of your former members are here. One original, both original, the complete original lineup is here, right?
Yeah.
We have Roy.
Roy, Sven is here.
And Sven is with Firefly. Roy is with a...
Luke is missing.
The original lineup is here.
And two of the original members are here, and they're celebrating their 100th competition. And
it's pretty cool.
Amazing.
So maybe that deserves a bottle of champagne.
Maybe we can give them one minute together.
Send them all the congratulations and celebrations. You know, like they like to hear this. You have a big following too. Meanwhile, right?
It's building. I think that is very important for the sport as well. Like I obviously we all want to perform, but I think what we can give and show to the sport, to the fans, that's that's also a very big thing for us. So yeah,
it has become a factor in the sport. When I was jumping, you know, we were champions and went to world meets and stuff, but who cared about it? But now you have hundreds and thousands of followers, fans, you know, of the sport, of the teams. It's fantastic, you know, that this is happening, and that was happening with and without the indoor. The indoor is, you know, accelerating everything.
Booming, yeah.
But so, if our viewers did want to follow you on social media, how should they find you?
Just on Facebook. You can search for NMP PCH HayaBusa, or okay. You just type in HayaBusa, so you're gonna get there as well.
Can I ask a WIFO question right now?
Yeah.
NMP PCH?
Yes.
What does it stand for?
National Military Parachuting Team, HayaBusa. It's just a shortage that we need, that we use for the army.
NMP is National Military, and the P stands for team in our language.
Okay.
PCH, parachuting, HayaBusa.
Okay, thank you very much.
Military team, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, you look like so soldierish.
Clean shaven, short hair.
Yeah, look. They have different rules in Belgium, I guess.
Undercover.
Yeah.
Undercover.
We're so much overseas.
Doesn't it feel? I mean, they don't even seem to think of round. What's coming up round four? So we can continue to chat here for a little while. They don't care about round four, as it seems like.
Is
that one of the fast ones already, or faster ones? Yeah.
Four and five are going to be the big scorers, and then tomorrow morning round seven. Round six tonight would be slow. Last round will be slower. And there's another slow one coming up tomorrow. I think it's 18.
18, 19, 14.
So what do you expect, Kurt, from the round number with the nine?
Nine BPA.
Well,
because
yesterday,
the round world, five. The indoor, let's say, unofficially world record is 66 Fury.
So yesterday.
It would be tough to beat, I guess. That was a real random
jump. Yeah, but that was a full random jump.
Yeah.
That was a full round.
There was an IPC. What did airspeed?
It was a preseason.
Yes. And that was with block 9. And that was with a block 9 in there, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So we need to see this fall, I guess, right?
Yeah.
So that's a target.
When we talked yesterday, we said high 40s.
Yesterday, I
low 50s.
I mentioned the 50s, and I'm expecting 50s.
Bold.
And if the 59 is falling and we see a 60 for the first official world record.
If you do that, Kurt will buy you champagne himself.
Woohoo! What do you think? I mean, you know the sequence.
Well, we have one. You haven't looked at it.
The one in.
Does it flow?
The one in Canada was more round. The whole jump. But now we're going from the B to the P to the A. It might slow it down a bit, but I would go, it's going to be high 50. It's going to be close. And if not, it has to go into the 60s.
The 59 was, by the way, now for the information, was the jump off at last year's World Indoor Championship between Russia and Airspeed. And Airspeed owns it, right?
Yeah.
Airspeed owns it. Okay, well, that will be interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're going to look at round five very carefully.
This is not an IPC meet, right?
No,
it's not going to change.
It's
not going to change it. It will be unofficial.
Yeah, the official, unofficial was here, the 66,
Furia?
Right?
Furia.
Yeah.
There is Fury.
Yeah, that's untouchable, though. 66, well, I think, eh?
Well, today. Well, I wouldn't. Well, untouchable. Yeah. I think you have, like, the good luck with the draw.
Was that when there was a sequence in it?
Yes, that was only random formation. Yeah. So this is not really a real super sequence. It's kind of a hybrid super sequence.
When all the blocks came out at the start, Kurt and I were just like, oh, please let it be five randoms in a row. Please let it happen.
Yeah, he did it.
Nine, I'm like,
he pulled them.
Nine is good.
Pulled them out the back.
How much slower do you think for round four, 4MGJ will be compared to the 9 BPA?
Well, the 4 is going to be much slower. And then the random MGJ is pretty quick, and the 4 block 9 is going to be way faster than a block 4.
Thinking 40s again? Or?
Yeah, for sure. 45.
Really?
Yeah.
In 35 working seconds.
Yeah, 45, you should count 46.
Yeah, that's going to go quick.
What about the 33.2 average? Is that going to fall? Possibly, maybe?
In the beginning of the competition, it's always difficult to feel. But now I think we already did the first three more slower rounds.
Right.
And if you already score like 25, or maybe even more, then
with the 25 in the bag for
why
that.
Stop?
Yeah.
You have to why not go?
Now I begin to see it too. I felt exactly the same. Let's see what the first rounds are bringing, and then. But with the 25 for the three block sequence, I think looks pretty good actually. Yeah. We shall see.
Question. Do you enjoy the rounds, or is it the flying, the 35 seconds, or is it just too much focus? You don't even like.
Except round one.
No, I mean, if a jump really comes together, then obviously you come out big fist pump and it feels really good.
Okay, and can you feel that while you're flying, or is it just a case of just complete focus?
No, definitely it's complete focus, but as
but you can see as it's going
it smooth, you still enjoy it because it goes like how you have it in your head.
Okay.
You know, if it doesn't really run like how you imagine it, then it's kind of a struggle. But as if a jump goes fine, it's actually super cool. I mean, very exciting.
But also you notice everything. Eh? I mean, the smallest hiccup you saw, or if it's the bump with the head against the knee, you felt everything you just see it more clearly because you're so focused. I mean, it's one of the things that we had to learn with Gary as well, is to open up your eyes as much as you can to see at least and to experience everything. If you just fly with your eyes closed or only by yourself, then you never know what's actually going on around you. And it's one of the plus points that we have, that we actually experience everything.
Yeah.
And I think also sometimes when they come out of the tunnel, they'll say to me, that was a good one. And if it's not, then I can see in their eyes. And then obviously I've watched it on the television. But then I know if it's not good, but they'll come out and even landing from a jump, they'll land and say, that was a good jump. And then you know it's, I don't want to say unbeatable, but it's a top score.
Yep.
And I think that's the feeling that Andy's saying is when you're flying, I can imagine when you're flying and then you know it's going perfect, you're enjoying it. You know, it's when you're playing good sport and you know you're at the top, everyone's watching you and you're doing great, then it's good.
So you know when you're in the zone.
Like Ronaldo.
Do you know when you're in the zone?
No, you know when you're in the zone.
Yeah. I thought if you knew you're in the zone, then you're no longer in the zone.
but you feel that you're in the zone. And it's not that if you really get conscious about it, then it's like what you say, you get out of it, but it's like, it's just...
How do you put yourself there? Like, I see you guys on the TV, like whoever's tail, forgive me, like as soon as your feet are off the tunnel flight, the floor, the carpet, you're actually flying straight away. And I don't see that with any other team quite as much. How do you prepare yourself to be there straight away for 10 rounds, every competition for the last 23 competitions?
Well, I think you get, by doing competitions, you get like a bit used to the feeling like of the stress you have, and or you can allow it to have your performance improve, or you can just go down because of the stress, and the stress is going to be there anyway, so we just use it to be more focused and to see everything, to whenever you pick up a grip that you really pick it up and not sloppy. So I think you just allow the stress that you have to have a higher focus.
I think also like everyone like has his own way of dealing with it for themselves as well, you know, like this team already experienced a lot of things like or ways how to deal with stress, and I think we're at the point now where everybody feels like this feels, it's still stressful of course, but we know really well how to deal with it now, and that's like Bob says, with a lot of experience and just doing it, you know.
Okay.
Well, I think it might be something that's hard for the rest, but we know that we can do it, that we can outjump everybody. So we know that in the back of our head that if we keep it together, then nobody's going to touch us. So
do you guys
I'm not saying it will happen, but knowing that for yourself that you can do it with the team is a great feeling to go in there.
It's also the confidence. If we take another sport, Ronaldo, Dave mentioned his name. We saw he did an incredible overhead kick. And that's kind of for him being in a zone. But when he goes onto the field, he believes he's unbeatable.
Yeah.
And I think you need to have that. It's an old days Michael Schumacher. When he got into the car, he believed he was going to win. And is it arrogance? I think we try and also inside the group stay humble, be humble champions. But at the end of the day, when you go and fly and you're standing in that door, if you're confident, you know that as that thing moves, it's going. It's all good and it's going. And I think that's the confidence that they're talking about, with having so many competitions behind them now, and of course having success, as the success breeds success.
They
keep going. So
how do you guys motivate yourself when you're training, like again and again?
Because I think the motivation comes because we know that there's many teams that want our position, so
it's almost a fear of not being top.
You know that everybody wants your slot, so you just go for it. You want to stay ahead. and that's our motivation. I think we keep on top of it.
And it's also breaking the boundaries. Eh? We know that the world record now is not on our name, so eventually we want to take it back. Highest outdoor world record is not on our name, so we want to take it back.
It's just a single round or average?
Yeah,
single round.
Average and single.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So everything that is not on the name, yeah, we wanted that.
You're not the world record holders for the average for four-way?
No.
What are you guys doing here? Come on.
Yeah. Why are you speaking to us? It's time for us to go?
That was when we were second.
Yeah. Looks like they're still not getting nervous, so we can talk a little bit more here. So I want to see when they will eventually begin to say, yeah, okay, I think
I'll leave first. Kurt and I got a different team.
Yeah. Kurt and I have been paid a lot of money to keep you here by all the other teams. Split.
I'm getting hungry here.
Oh, yeah, you were on your way to eat something, yeah, actually, right?
Okay,
shall we let them go? Or?
I have two last questions.
Okay.
Go ahead.
If you could never fly in a tunnel again, or never skydive again, which one would you choose? Or if you could only fly in the tunnel again, or only fly in the jump in the sky again?
One or both?
Yeah.
I would definitely go skydiving.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah?
Me too, yeah.
Okay.
Even me as an old man.
Good answer.
Okay.
I agree.
Yeah. I think it's more complete. I mean, tunnel flying is cool, it's fast, you have to fly without the rig, and you have more mobility. But jumping out of an aircraft, I don't know, it's a different feeling.
Just right. Quickly, were you guys all skydivers before you flew in the tunnel?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
I had to think.
Okay, so it'll be interesting when their new breed do come through.
Yeah, exactly. Never
skydive. Okay. Exactly. And then secondly, we're trying to catch every single team for the TV show. If you wouldn't mind just giving us a quick signature there, just say you've been here.
Yeah.
Cheers, Bob. Cheers, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I really appreciate you being here.
For the good questions.
The same. NMP, PCH, HayaBusa. Lunchtime.
Bye.
Yeah. Bye, everyone. We'll be back very shortly.
Thank you, guys.